Yeah, and I wasn't really sure going in terms of, like, you know, FKTs, you can go out and kind of do what you want, be out all hours, run through the night. And I wasn't sure, you know, how that would fly in terms of, first off, there's a lot of, like, Bedouin camps with really aggressive dogs and things like safety. So, yeah, it was a little bit different in terms of just setting up the details and whatnot of the FKT attempt.
Kia ora tātou. That was Amy Sproston. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
And this is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners.
Can you hear that? What you got?
It's mail. It is. In the first couple of episodes we ever did,
yep,
we pretended to open letters. This shoe company who was suing us. But this is an actual letter addressed to Dirt Church Radio at 5 Riverhead Street, Riverhead.
You don't want to talk about that being sued anymore.
No.
Yeah, lawyers have said. Yeah.
But anyway, look, we'll open it. It is addressed to Dirt Church Radio.
It's literally opening a letter.
And literally,
it's got a stamp and everything.
It does. Oh, it says heart further faster. Something very cool. Oh, has it got? Oh, it's kind of sticky. But look, it looks like the front cover of National Geographic.
It does.
And it is Further Faster Volume 2. And Further Faster in Christchurch, New Zealand's ultimate independently owned outdoors retailer,
the bestest,
are having their new shop open this weekend. And they've busted and they took out their neighbours and they've opened the shop up and it's really wide. And, if you go down to 57A and B Buchan Street in Christchurch, you can hang out with them all the time.
Badger.
Go see Badger. Go see Rocky.
Yeah.
And they say it's not just
featuring on the cover there.
Featuring on the cover. It's not just an outdoor store. We are outdoor gear haven made for you. So you did this. Thank you. Oh, so good.
Wow.
Wish we were here with you guys, there with you guys. Further Faster, supporting us with the good gears and supporting you guys.
Mm. Get amongst it.
Get amongst it.
Can't wait to get down there. Right. Wild Things.
Yes.
If you use the code
DCR2020.
Yes. You get 15 months for the price of 12. I know we keep banging on about that, but it's such a good deal.
Good community. Access to the trial directory.
Yep.
Access to gear. Access to specials.
Yes.
Access to
races. They're always giving away races.
Yep. They're really good races.
Really good races.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Get amongst it, people. DCR 2020. Use that code. You can sign up to Wild Things. 15 months for a price of 12. Why wouldn't you? And we get a little kickback from it as well.
A little bit of a kickback there.
Yep. All right. Cool.
Ultra Spire. You will notice a shuffling sea level dwelling herbivore in any of the promotional Fresh Choice Kepler Challenge. What pack is the natural pack of the Kepler Challenge? It's the Zygos 4, and you'll see a photo of yours truly wearing it, going up to Mount Luxmore.
Not just wearing it, rocking it.
Well, we're rolling it than rocking it. But look, fantastic gear, fantastic packs. Ultra Spire sponsor us, and we wear their gear, and we love their gear. And if you go to ultraspire.nz, you're in luck, because the Zygos 4 is back in stock. And I've had plenty of people actually getting in touch with me going, do you really wear that pack? I'm like, I wear that pack a lot. And how good it is.
The Zygos is so good.
Yeah.
I've had three of them.
Yes, I've had two of them.
Mm.
Best iteration yet.
So good.
Church Radio.
So you should probably start.
Shall I start?
Yes.
All right. Episode 144.
No.
Well, could be. It's from the future. 114? How about that?
114, yeah, that's
114, we made it.
Eugene's not been leaving his house a lot, so.
We didn't make it as far as I just said, but we've made it. Yeah.
Yeah, we made it. It's good to be in your ears, and it's good to see you, brother. And how good was it this weekend to see so many people out getting amongst it?
Man, there's so many races on at the weekend.
Yeah, absolutely.
The old social medias was going crazy. People, you know, racing all ends of the country.
Yep.
It was awesome.
It was so good and generally good to be back to, you know, a good form of normal. And, how good was it to have Megan Hicks on last week?
Oh,
I love that chat.
Yeah, like I'm a, I'm a legitimate I Run Far nerd, and you know, like I remember Titirangi Library finding Relentless Forward Progress and being so impressed with it. So it was so good to get to chat, and you know, her greatest run ever was fantastic as well.
It was. Hey, I just wanted to do a quick throwback too. Mm-hmm. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the claw at the Blue Lake 24 Hour.
Yeah, we why is it called that?
Well, we were riffing about it, weren't we?
Yeah.
Well, we actually have an answer.
Right.
Some guy called Andrew McDowell.
Andrew McDowell, I think. He's been a bit quiet of late.
Yeah, I think it's his name, Andrew McDowell. Yeah, that's it. That's it. Anyway, who else? Sorry. Thanks, Andrew. He got in touch to say it's because the name of the that's the name of the trophy that's up for grabs if you can run 200 kilometres. It was apparently supposed to be a Game of Thrones one, but when it turned up, it had been all smashed up, and the only bit that remained was the claw.
Ah, okay. So if you can run the 200 kilometres in 24 hours. Oh, that's why he was like, it was actually quite hard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Yeah. So there you go. That's what that's what we're here for.
Yeah. But this week we have Amy Sproston, who originally from the US has achieved at the highest levels of the sport. You know, she's been she's won the world 100 kilometer champs with Team USA. She's podiumed twice at Western States, two additional top 10 finishes. She did the Tour de Jeanne in 2019, and most recently she destroyed the FKT on the 660-kilometre Jordan Trail in 8 days, 9 hours and 28 minutes, to be precise. And I had the chance, and she was very, very generous because I'm not so good with time zones, and I buggered up the time, and we got together. It was 6 o'clock in the morning my time, 8 o'clock in the evening her time, and had a great old chin wag, and she was really generous and a very, very interesting conversation about and that part of the world.
Because she's still in Jordan.
Yeah, yeah. Well, she's based in Jordan. She works in Jordan, and she says it in the podcast that it increasingly is feeling a bit more like home to her. So,
wow.
Yeah.
I never got to Jordan. Really wish I did.
Yeah. I didn't get anywhere near Jordan. I've never been
Yeah, I've been up and around, but never actually got there. And it's, yeah, like, you're not supposed to have regrets, but I do regret not going to Jordan.
Next time. Yeah.
Yeah. But how you been, man?
Well, look, I mean, again, you know, Sunday morning found me running around Riverhead on some quite sore legs after talking to Amy and just kind of reflecting how fortunate I am, you know, like I know we bang on about it a lot, but it seems like at the moment, like reflecting just on the good privilege and fortune that we have and that I have, and the gratitude for my life is really good for the brain. You know, I got up in the morning, talked to this wonderful person about the wonderful stuff that she's doing, and then went out and got amongst it in Riverhead with no one on the trails because it was early. And it's strange in a way to have the social media feeds back up and running with heaps of people going out and getting amongst it. And it felt a bit alien, to be honest, and perhaps even a little bit overwhelming, but also a real celebration of the fact that at this point in Aotearoa, we've eliminated COVID-19 in our community.
Again.
Yeah, again. And it seemed like because we've been limited by what we can do and who we can do it with, and I'm looking at me and you and every other Dorklander out there, it's you know, this was the first weekend that we were all at level one and everyone just got out there and partied in the outdoors and people just really went off.
Totally.
You know, and I'll talk about this too. Two things that really struck out to me. And it's not on the trails, but it's an incredible thing. You know, Hayden Wilde went out to attempt Bill Bailey's 1964 one-hour track record of 20.190 kilometres, and he fell just short, 301 metres short to be precise, at 19.889. It's an amazing effort, and the dude's a triathlete.
Yeah.
And
Craig Kirkwood,
yeah, absolutely. Yep. And that wouldn't have been possible with and we had the first Bledisloe Cup test. I mean, how good was that to watch? I mean, I did set a new heart rate threshold, but it's so good to be back watching sport.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was a great game, and it was, you know, we're talking about rugby, by the way, people who aren't familiar with our funny sports, but it was good, and it was great to see some competitiveness between our two nations.
Yeah, absolutely. We were like, with our Australian dog, we were like, oh, it's okay. Oh, get outside. Oh, come back in. You're a good boy. Yeah. Oh, get outside. Yeah.
You hit the post. Get out.
Yeah. That's right. And how have you been going?
Yeah, well, sort of in the same vein, really, because I got to go back to Parkrun on Saturday. So Parkrun started up in the rest of Aotearoa a couple of weeks back when they all went to level one, and then Auckland had its back in level one on Saturday. So it was really cool to go back and say hi to heaps of people, especially to catch up with our mate Dave.
Mm.
So he's coming back from a long-term injury, and it was funny talking
looking
to him.
Even buffer than usual.
Well, to be honest, you know, since I've seen him, his hair looked different and he was so buff and I didn't recognise him hardly. You know, I was like, hey, Eugene. And I was like, whoa, Dave. But it was funny talking to him about his injury and my injury and a couple of other mates of ours' injuries, and we realised we were at that stage, right, we almost need a spreadsheet to keep track of everyone's injuries. Oh, man, it sucks getting old. But anyway, it was great to be back at Parkrun. And, you know, I incorporated it in a long run because I was missing out on catching up with you. So I sacrificed that to go to catch up at Parkrun. Did the long ride on Sunday with Tom and Thomas.
Yeah.
Got a bit of stick for the old Muppet joke last week.
Yeah, well, no, it's the...
To be clear, I wasn't calling anyone a Muppet.
No. Yeah. But if the... We have two friends who are the living embodiment of Waldorf and Statler, so if the...
They've now changed their names to that in our chat group.
If the nickname sticks, it sticks.
Yeah, yeah. And we caught up for a coffee with Harry and Saywan, which was fantastic. It was really good to see Harry looking pretty chipper after a scary accident a few weeks back.
It's amazing. Rebecca said to me, you know, in terms of Harry, you know, like our friend, he, you know, he broke his foot and his other leg. Mm. One leg, one foot, one hand, his right hand. And she said, you know, like one of the things that will really benefit him is he's young.
Yeah.
He's fit. He'll have dense bones, great tendons, great everything because of the amount of running he does.
Yeah, so definitely.
It's good to see the man back up. Stirring his soy milk.
Yeah, yeah. So that was, pretty action-packed weekend and all. Mm. So.
Do it. Stuff you should
know. Sound like Andrew McDowell. Right, you've got it.
Yeah, so I just wanted to say, because I had an epiphany on the weekend where I went, Rebecca, my wife and I was putting my stuff out to get up early, to go running early. And she said, mate, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm getting up to go run and so I can be back early to kind of not, you know, before anyone knows I'm gone, so I can, you know, hang out with the kids and you and do all this stuff. And she said, look, why don't you just have a bit of a sleep in and go for a run later, because we're actually okay. And it really struck me, the fact that, you know, that's been my sort of existence with running over the last decade. Having three young children who are all a bit older now. And I just wanted to say to all the parents out there who are struggling getting in long runs or any runs in and around your children, doing the juggle with your better half, getting out at all hours, looking longingly at your peers with no children or older children, and generally putting in the mahi where it should be around your whānau, your family, keep doing what you're doing because you're doing the right thing. And as frustrating as it feels, and as much as you compare yourself to other people, things do change. People do grow older, and the work that you're putting in now, being present and being there for your family, will pay off dividends in the long run.
Absolutely. Well said.
Mm.
Mm. Early morning starts.
Early morning starts, ooh, which is still excellent, by the way. Like, it's not, I'm not going to turn into like an 11 o'clock brunch runner, but like, you know, it's that sense of, not that there's anything against 11 o'clock brunch runners, but you know, like that sense of getting up early and getting it done before the is fantastic. Mm. But also,
having a sleep in when
you're having a normal amount of sleep is fantastic.
Luxury.
As well.
Yeah.
Right. On to the racing this weekend.
Yeah. So, a lot to get through. Yep. The Taupo Ultra. Taupo. It looked like half of the North Island was at that one.
And I did. I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Like, I normally feel a great sense of FOMO for that sort of stuff. I love total sport races. I do like, and it seems like everyone we know and love was there and sending us pictures and tagging us and stuff. But man, what a ding dong that turned out. Well, not actually, it call the police because there was a murder in the 100K.
Was
Carl Reed, who's been on the show before, won Ultraman twice and then was like, I could do it all in one day. Anyway, Carl Reed led from the front and he smashed it.
Mm.
Yeah, he took 20 minutes off the course record, his course record, and came in 8 hours, 3 minutes and 30 seconds.
Mm. More than an hour and a quarter, well, almost an hour and a quarter ahead. Skipped the prize giving though, because he had to go pick up his new rescue puppies.
Oh, what a...
Yeah. And so he said, I can't believe I took out the 100K for the second year running and also smashed the course record. I was in a world of hurt, and being solo all day was a huge mental battle. I dug deep and just went for it. The course is brutal but spectacular. What a place to run. Huge thanks to everyone for the support. Just epic, epic, epic. So there were, I mean, there were some other pretty impressive things that happened.
Yeah.
During the day, Nick Johnson,
King of Riverhead.
Yeah. Previous 100K.
Yeah.
Record holder won the 50K just a few weeks after coming third at Rotorua.
Yep. Troy Field, who came in second in the 50K, was running his first ever ultra, and I saw that on James's Instagram. He sort of collapsed as he went to his knees as he went across the line. Really? It was pretty spectacular.
Oh, wow. Will Samuel, who founded the Taupo Ultra, and he was third in the 50K. So,
excellent.
Great stories there.
Ben and Yoni Keeps completed the 100 kilometre in 10 hours, 5 minutes and 42 seconds for an impressive top 10 father-son 100-kilometre finish, and was still at the finish line over 12 hours later to see their friend finish at 3:30 in the morning the following day. It's probably still trying to digest that monstrous burger that they ate.
Yeah. Yes. That. Gene Rand. What about poor old Gene Rand? He was leading the 74K by 14 minutes, and then he took a fall at 50K and dislocated his collarbone.
Oh, dude.
Youchies. Youch. Yeah. So the results.
Okay, kick it. Do it.
All right. So Kanoka Azumi won the women's in 10 hours, 11 minutes, 43 seconds. Laura Pfeiffer was second in 10:24:47, and Sarah Healy third in 11:42:40.
In the male, the men, it was Carl Reed of rural South Auckland in 8 hours, 3 minutes and 32 seconds. Tom Peck, and that's still very, very classy, but ages behind, in 9 hours, 16 minutes and 21 seconds. And Keith Poor was bringing up third place in 9 hours, 25:20.
Yeah. In the 74K, it was Jennifer Overend in 8:27 flight, Jamie Stevenson 8:29:46, and Brittany Saldarelli in 8:42:21.
Daniel Ray bringing home the 74 kilometres for the men in 6:50:46. Brett Clayton in 7 hours, 29 minutes and 53 seconds, and Alex Hunt in third place, 7 hours, 37 minutes and 16 seconds.
Uh-huh. And in the 50K, Sue Crowley, 4 hours, 15:51, Karis Teo, 4:25:31, and Angela Campbell, 4:40:27.
In the men, Nick Johnson, you monster, in 3 hours, 46 minutes and 45 seconds. Troy Field was second in 4 hours, 53, and Will Samuels. So 4 hours 00:53, and Will Samuels in 4:14:17.
Epic. Right. There was heaps of other people that we knew.
Absolutely.
Down.
So again, you know, everyone's like, "Yay, we're here," and you're not. But you know, two people we got to shout out to, two of your journalistic whānau, Scotty Stevenson knocking out a very impressive 5:41 in the 50K with his training buddy
Dylan Cleaver
banging out tidy 5:24.
And there was so many others down there, weren't there? So just so pleased that everyone got to have fun on the trails.
Absolutely.
Speaking of having fun on the trails and the hills and stuff, Three Peaks in Dunedin. Oof. So people got the bagpipes out, a bit of that action.
Three Peaks plus one.
Yeah, so Three Peaks has been going since 1984, named after the three peaks of Flagstaff, Swampy and Mount Cargill.
Yeah.
And this year they added in Three Peaks plus one. So the course took a detour from the top of Flagstaff before joining back up with the rest at Swampy Summit and continuing on to Mount Cargill. So, yeah, in total, 52K for that event. And, like, it looked like a bit of a – I sort of saw that halfway Tom Spencer was in first with Chris Bisley following along and Tom Riley in third. But Chris Bisley got up for the win. Surprise, surprise. Yeah. But in the women's you know, Sharon LeCue.
Yep.
She was just smashing it from the get-go by the looks of it. Yeah. And, you know, at the top of Swampy, there was an interview with her in which she was just charging on. And she said that she'd had a chest infection, which she certainly wasn't showing any signs of that. But, you know, breed them tough down south.
They breed them tough. And those are some pretty impressive times. So Chris Bisley took it home in 5 hours, 20 minutes and 5 seconds. Lewis Latham came 5 hours, 22 minutes and 33 seconds. And Tom Spencer of Dunedin, 5 hours, 25 minutes and 16 seconds.
Yeah, so Sharon Lecue was 6 hours, 2 minutes and 39 seconds, 10th overall as well.
Sick.
Yeah, and then there was a second equal.
Yeah, that's rad.
Yeah, Christy Isles and
Orlaith Heron.
Orlaith Heron. Yep, in 6:43:28. Oh, so, yeah.
The 26K defending champion Hamish Elliott, there was a bit of an upset. So Elliott trailed winner Mac Ogden by 43 seconds as Ogden locked in 2 hours, 11 minutes, 53 seconds. Wow. And that was more than 5 minutes slower than Elliott's winning time from last year. Harry Wager was another minute back in third.
Mm. And Kirsty Moffat won the women's race in the 26, 2 hours, 42:48, 4 minutes ahead of Chloe Gaultier and Fiona Love.
Fiona Love, yeah.
Good old Fiona Love, our friend Fiona Love, 2:46:58. Yeah. I do have to tell you that, so the race results for the 26 were actually messed up, and these come from the ODT.
Do they?
Yeah, the good old ODT Steve came through Tripp, for us. Yeah.
Jeez.
Good old ODT came through for us. Never let a bad word be said about that, Rick.
Only thing right about the ODT is the date, mate.
Turns out no.
For those wondering, they actually did publish a really quite vitriolic letter to the editor that I wrote to them once.
Yes. So there was also the Abel Tasman Coastal Classic. That race has been around forever.
Absolutely.
You know, it's 33 kilometres from Awaroa to Marahau along the Abel Tasman National Park trail. And it's been going since 1994. And how's this for a list of previous competitors?
All right.
Scott Molina.
Ooh.
Aaron Baker. Greg Frayne. Yeah. Jonathan Wyatt. Tracy Clissold. Michelle Allison. Phil Costley. Rod Dixon.
Oh.
Not bad.
Not bad at all.
Not bad.
Okay, so in first place for the men in 2:24:27 was Flavio Viana of Christchurch. Second was Vajan Armstrong, up and comer, in 2:28.
He's got some promise, that guy.
He's got some promise. No, just stick to music, mate. And in 2:34:58, Darren Jones of Nelson. So yep. Fantastic.
And in the women, Kirsten Wright, 2:54:44. Annabelle Bramwell, 2:57:45. And AB Natras, 3:10:36.
Yep.
Yeah. So there you go. I also just wanted to do a quick shout out to Ruby Muir. So she laid down a 2:46 marathon PB in Marston, which was the Wairarapa Country Marathon. It doubled as the Wellington Marathon Champs. So, yeah, whoop. So thanks to Chan for the
That's
heads
amazing.
Up on that. Yeah. There were some other good names in that race as well. A certain Mal Aiken.
Yeah. Well,
won
Mal
the half
Aiken.
Marathon.
Of course she did.
Yeah.
Of course she won the half marathon.
Yeah. 1:22:41.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, yeah, it looked like a nice day in the Wairarapa. Is there anything else other than a nice day in the Wairarapa?
I don't think so.
And next weekend.
Yeah.
Holy moly.
It's a worldwide, you think Zoom meetings are boring? Well, they kind of are, but if they're going on right around the world and for days and days, they're pretty exciting. It's the Big's Backyard Virtual Run next weekend. And the Aotearoa New Zealand team is kicking off at 1 a.m. On Sunday the 18th of October, which is just an hour after midnight, or Saturday, the day after our election. So it's a huge, and, you know, 12 hours before the second bled is low.
Mm.
Goodness me. It's going to be great.
So it's all going to be on Zoom, right?
Yep, it's all going to be on Zoom.
So do you think every hour is going to start with, I can see you, can you see me?
Yeah.
Hey, Germany, you're on mute. We can't, hello. That's dropped out.
Yeah. Right.
Hello.
No.
It's going to be that awkwardness.
I hope not.
What's the Wi-Fi like in Riverhead?
Well, actually, Sean Collins has got, he's enlisted the people who we were going to get with the relamps, and it's boosted. He's got an aerial. So
Riverhead for the weekend is going to have wicked.
Arrimoo Valley Road is the place to be. if you're there, come out, head out to Arrimoo Valley Road in Riverhead and come hang out. We're going to be out. I'm going to be out there.
Yeah, I'm going to get along. Yeah, go and cheer people along. And
yeah.
I mean, you know, we're talking about it. Yesterday, it's not an easy course.
No, it's not an easy course at all.
And I imagine that some countries have given themselves an easier road to run.
I don't know. I mean, it's not in the... I don't know if that's the spirit of the event, and I'm not sure how that'll be... It'll come out in the wash. But, I mean, it's an amazing format. It's a mass start.
Yes.
And so your country keeps going, so there's got to be two people in it.
Mm, mm.
So that sets up a real... ding dong. It's going to be really.
And it makes it brings along that team element, doesn't it? It's going to be great.
It's going to be great.
It's going to be great.
Tell you what else is great.
Greatest run ever,
which is the part of the show where we ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. Might just be a run round the block or setting the FKT on the Jordan Trail. Something that's sung to you for some reason, you could send it in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And this is from Steve Frank. Hey team, long-time listener and long-time ponderer of my greatest run ever. In all the time I've spent trying to pick my greatest run ever, there've been plenty that stood out, all for different reasons. Parkrun PBs, where I find the ability to push beyond where I think possible and the suffering is only outweighed by the satisfaction when crossing the finish. Mountain runs with new friends, where the kilometres are effortless, the conversation free, the foot placement perfect and the views endless. Sneaky mountain missions in fresh snow, where the skies are wild, the snow dry and untouched, and the happiness and freedom so immense I grin and laugh the entire time. Early morning missions in the dark with the pup, with the joy of sunrise from a mountaintop all to ourselves. But though all the time I've spent wondering what my greatest run ever is, I've come to realise that I can't single out just one. If I look at every run I've been on through the lens of greatest run ever, there's a reason why they're all worthy. Be it the runs where I didn't want to go out of the house and came back feeling recharged, runs where the feet have been sore and I managed the short distance pain-free, short runs in jandals to a friend's house where the temperature is perfect and the skies are full of character, or runs where I've simply enjoyed the freedom and privilege of being able to run. They've all been worthy. I've just needed to look at them differently. Thanks for giving me a new perspective on running. I'm off to have another greatest run ever.
Oh,
that is brilliant.
That's brilliant.
That is absolutely brilliant.
That's so right.
Thank you, sir.
So
yes.
Right. If you have the right perspective, every run can be greatest
so
run
much
ever.
Perspective.
Yeah. Yeah.
We've wow. We're getting some amazing greatest runs ever in, but we do need some more.
Yes,
so
we do.
Send them in.
All right. I promise not to be violent this week. Yeah. Come on, send them in. Oh, damn, so, I just can't help myself.
You're like being savaged by a duck. So... Right, on to our feature conversation. I had the pleasure to speak with Amy Sproston about her FKT on the Jordan Trail and how that and had the added importance for the country in the current context of the international tourism being shut down due to the pandemic. We spoke about Amy's life as an elite and ultramarathoner, how this has changed in focus due to injury. We spoke about her travels, her development work, gender issues, and indeed how a cheeseburger from McDonald's might just be the perfect sports food. So without further delay, Amy Sproston.
Ditch Radio.
All the way from Amman, Jordan, I'm on the line with Amy Sproston. Amy, kia ora, how are you?
I'm great, how are you?
I'm really well. Thanks for coming on Dirt Church Radio. Obviously, wanted to catch up with you about your amazing FKT of the Jordan Trail and just everything else, well, not everything else, but you know your long storied running career. But I guess first off is how are you doing over there?
I'm doing pretty well. Actually, we're on lockdown again. So Jordan has been kind of an interesting case in terms of COVID. We were on a really strict lockdown initially in March and into April, and then had kind of a COVID-free bubble for a lot of May and June, and then had some people escape quarantine, and it's now in like August, September, it's been spreading pretty rampantly. And so as of Thursday night at midnight, they put us back on weekend lockdown. So from Thursday at midnight until Sunday morning at 6 each week, we can't leave our houses. So the Jordan Trail was really well timed, because had it been a week later, I would have been stopped a couple of days from the finish. So.
And is that a complete lock? Like can't leave the house to exercise, can't leave the house to go to prayers, can't leave the house to do anything?
Can't leave the house, period. Yeah, it's been like ghost town silence all weekend, which has been lovely for me because I'm just, you know, kind of lounging around watching Netflix and recovering. But yeah, just complete silence, no cars, no people out walking.
It's quite eerie, right? You go from, you know, the normal kind of sounds of human beings cohabiting together to nothing. We experienced that in March when we got put on a very strict lockdown here. You know, everyone just had to basically stay indoors, except they, you know, some of us who could stay out doing essential work. It's quite a change, isn't it?
It is quite a change. And I think because we've had so much freedom lately, it's a little bit of a shock. But I guess, especially for coming off the Jordan Trail, it's just, I've got two cats, and I've just been kind of lounging and really enjoying some really quiet time with the cats and some pets. So.
Oh, that's good that you can take a silver lining from it. And here's hoping that it's you know, a successful countermeasure to kind of get a lid on what's happening. But I just wanted to talk in general. I mean, how long have you been in Jordan for?
I got to Jordan in August of 2019, and prior to Jordan, I was based in Beirut, Lebanon, for about 4 months, all with the same organization and the same program. So yeah, I left the States in like April of 2019. And prior to this, I'd been based out of Bend, Oregon, also working for the same Mercy Corps, the same NGO. So it's a large international humanitarian organization.
Wow. And so what do you do with the Mercy Corps?
I am the ethics and assurance manager on our Syria program, which is based out of Amman here. So.
Wow. Sounds like.
So I do like fraud and corruption investigations and things like that.
Wow. So within the NGO itself, or as it pertains to your sort of interactions with other organizations?
Kind of both, but yeah, within the organization.
Wow. Gosh. Sounds like a very, very full-on job.
It is, yeah. It's definitely been it's definitely a very busy job. So it's interesting. So it keeps me occupied.
Yeah, yeah. And I guess from Bend, Oregon to Syria is quite a big that's a big shift. But I understand that you've lived and run in some quite far-flung places of the world, yeah?
Yeah, and I've been with Mercy Corps for 11 years now, and prior to that I was with another, like a USAID contractor, so I've been doing the same type of work for, you know, going on 17, 18 years now, and so I've always traveled for work. I've just been generally based out of the U.S. and not based overseas, and that, a lot of that had to do with racing and sponsorships and things like that, but yeah, I've had some injuries the past couple of years, and kind of loss of sponsors, and so I decided to kind of make a big change and ended up here. So.
Wow. When you moved to Jordan, how long did it take you to kind of think about, you know, running the Jordan Trail?
You know, when I was based in Lebanon, there's a similar trail in Lebanon called the Lebanon Mountain Trail, and it's a lovely kind of like mainly single track. I think it's probably like around 200 miles. I can't remember the exact distance. So I'd kind of gotten the itch to do that. But when I was in Lebanon last year, I've got some knee arthritis. And so at that point I wasn't really running. And so never had the chance to really, I mean, I would go out and explore parts of it, but never had the chance to do it. And so then when I got to Jordan and found out there was a Jordan Trail, kind of after exploring some of the sections of it, and because Tour de Jean was canceled this year, I wanted something that would kind of replace that, and so that's why I did the timing of it in September, and decided to go ahead was to really replace the tour this year.
Right. So you'd signed up for the tour, and then everything being canceled everywhere, it just sort of fell.
Yeah, exactly. I did tour last year, and so I'd really wanted to go back and do it again.
It's. I mean. Even down here in little old New Zealand, we had one of our close friends who'd signed up for the tour as well, and he was gutted that he couldn't do it. But it sounds like an incredible experience in itself.
Yeah, I mean, the Jordan Trail it's probably one of my top kind of running, like long, week-long running experiences of my life. And so, I'm really feel fortunate the way it worked out in the end, so...
One of the things that really sort of intrigued me is it sounds like you had quite a lot of support from the local running club. I had a look on their website, Running Amman. It sounds like there's a really quite a established scene in Jordan.
Yeah, there really is. And Running Amman, it's the kind of the local like Amman running club that they put on runs 3 days a week, and then sometimes we do trail runs on Saturdays. But yeah, one of my friends from Running Amman, one of the two guys in charge, his name is Razum. He really, when he found out I wanted to do this, he really just kind of spearheaded the effort. And without his assistance and kind of, you know, connections in terms of getting to the sport. Like it never would have happened. And so I feel really fortunate that they jumped on board and really kind of supported me throughout the whole effort. So.
Mm. And I guess, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but running in a country like Jordan would have a different sort of, you know, the cultural context and everything like that would be quite different from, you know, trying to set an FKT on a trail in your home state. Yeah.
Yeah. And I wasn't really sure going in terms of, like, you know, FKTs, you can go out and kind of do what you want, be out all hours, run to the night. And I wasn't sure, you know, how that would fly in terms of, first off, there's a lot of like Bedouin camps with really aggressive dogs and things like safety. So yeah, it was a little bit different in terms of just setting up the details and whatnot of the FKT attempt.
But everything sounds like it came off pretty smoothly.
Yeah, it's funny because about a week before, kind of all the plans, they all fell through, and then some calls were made, some things happened, and then all of a sudden everything was back on, and like back on with like twice the support. So I had an amazing crew. I had Razum from Running Amman. I had a coordinator from the tourism board, a guy named Bonnie Hani. I had a guy from Trex, which is like a local, it's both a mountaineering shop, and they also lead like hikes and expeditions. And so they were on board. And then I had a videographer named Ollie who was there throughout the journey too. So I had a kind of four key core guys that were there for the whole time, and they were absolutely phenomenal.
Wow. Sounds like everyone really sort of got behind you in terms of, you know, both, you know, being supportive of you and promoting the trail and I guess Jordan itself, hey?
Yeah, no, it worked out. In the end, it was amazing, like team effort, and especially with the year with like, you know, everything's been canceled. There is no tourism. Like there's the through hikes aren't happening on the trail, etc. It really, I think, worked out for everyone for the best.
That's amazing. And what a trail. I mean, you know, I remember watching, you know, there's that iconic, it's Petra, isn't it? The building that's carved out of the rock or the city.
Yeah.
You know, I remember as a child watching Indiana Jones films or, you know, and it's all sort of running around there. I mean, goodness me, it's such a history to the place.
Yeah, I mean, the trail is really stunning. And throughout the trail, it changed from north to south. It changes so much as well. And when you start in the north, you start in Umkais. And from Umkais, like where the trail starts, you're up at this site of like Roman ruins with all these columns, and you're looking out to the north and you can see like the Sea of Galilee, and you can see Syria, you can see Palestine, Israel, Jordan, you can see the Golden Heights. So it's like the history and like the everything that's happened in that small region of the world. I mean, the importance of that that area. So you start there, and then, you know, the first couple of days you're on kind of big rolling hills through like olive groves and pomegranate farms and again, a lot of ruins and castles. And then you get down into like the wadi section, which is wadis or like the canyons. And so some really technical big descents and climbs. And then you get to Dana, which is a big biosphere reserve. It's got a beautiful canyon you run down into. And that's like the section before you get to Petra. And then from Petra, you enter some like slot canyons and seeks, and it's just, and then you get to Wadi Rum, which Wadi Rum, if you watched any like movie that has scenes from Mars, like The Martian or Lawrence of Arabia from way back, there's any number of movies that have been filmed in Wadi Rum, and it's just a stunning desert landscape that looks very much like a moonscape. It's just a
really
gorgeous area. And so like, and then you know drop down over some mountains and get down to Aqaba and the Red Sea, which is just a gorgeous body of water as well. So I mean, the whole trail is stunning, and it's just really quite the journey because of all the history and culture and just the region. It's an amazing trail.
And it sounds like you had some help and sort of advice from the previous FKT holders, Robbie and Dan.
I reached out to Robbie a couple of months before I planned to do it, and we had, you know, a phone conversation. He was super helpful, you know, giving me information via email, and we've been in contact after. And yeah, they've been great, so really helpful.
And I mean, you mentioned before, you know, like it's, I mean, this is an incredible, you know, eight days, 9 hours, 28 minutes that's massive with everything that, you know, the heat and the terrain. I mean, I'd like to go back to sort of your history, if I may. I mean, how did you start in running or going to trail and ultra running?
Yeah, I mean, I've been a runner I'm 46. I've been running since I was 12. So I've run for a very long time. And kind of after college, after grad school, after Peace Corps, I'd come back to the U.S. and I was living in D.C. So this is around 2006 was the year I did my first ultra. So I met some trail runners in Washington, D.C. and got into ultras with the big local club there called the Virginia Happy Trails Running Club. And met some really like diehard ultra types that were doing, you know, like races every month. And so I quickly got kind of sucked into that, you know, running 8 or 10 races a year. And had some success early on, and a few years later moved to Oregon, and then I started running for like the Mantra Mountain Hardware team and some sponsors that went along with that team. And so then I kind of really got into some of the more competitive races when I got out to the West Coast in Oregon.
Well, yeah, I mean, looking at hit a second, a third, and 2/8 at Western States. I mean, that's, it seems like it was that real heyday of the first sort of, not the first wave of ultramarathon running, but certainly when it became, I guess, more disseminated with social media, and then there were the first sort of wave of real worldwide interest, hey?
Yeah, and I guess there's some really, I mean, people keep talking every year, like, you know, every year, like, the field gets more and more competitive, but definitely in some of those Western states back in, you know, 2000, I think that would have been like 11, 12, 13, I think 16, were when I was racing out there. And we had some, I mean, there's some really strong women's fields. And I think that was the time that, you know, the women were really coming into the sport, and there was a lot more competition and more sponsorship and whatnot.
Mm. And then you said the change of, you know, going to Western States sponsored, and then sort of the injury happened and things change, hey?
Yeah, like, I mean, and I'd been with Columbia Montreal for like 9 or 10 years, and then that kind of stopped. And so, yeah, it was, and I'd also been in the same job for several years, and was just looking for kind of a change. So that's kind of when I decided to leave my current position there and just make a major kind of life change and focus on my career more than running. And just kind of let my knees calm down. So yeah, but running it seems to be like during the Jordan Trail, like I didn't once feel my knees. And so definitely feeling healthy again and looking to keep taking on some big adventures.
That's amazing. And I mean, how did you find the transition from, I mean, you know, I don't believe Carl Meltzer, who says 100 miles isn't that far. I just don't. Going from, you know, that sort of distance and smaller to these big, big events, like something like, you know, 330K of Tour de Jean. What was that transition like?
For me at the time, I mean, because again, last year was when I was really having some issues with my knees. So I really went into Tour, definitely more with the mentality of training in a way that I could get to the start line healthy. And then basically not doing anything to like blow up my knees early on. So I was really just focusing on like my hiking fitness. And I also wanted to be happy and finish the Tour like with a positive like race. And so I allowed myself to sleep more than, I mean, if you want to do well at Tour, you basically have to suffer through sleep deprivation and kind of be a walking zombie. And I had crewed one year and kind of seen that. And I really wanted to just like enjoy the race, take in the experience. And so I allowed myself, I mean, I probably slept 15 hours over the race, which
right.
Still a ton over like 100, like I did like 107 hours, but it did allow me to really kind of enjoy the journey and maintain my kind of happy spirit throughout. Like I now like to go back and be a little more competitive and do the sleep deprivation thing and get a higher position there. But it was definitely a great first experience.
It's interesting that you said, you know, like I wanted to be happy because it certainly for, I mean, I guess non-competitive, well, non-elite runners, there's that emphasis on, you know, we do this to be happy, we do this to be, but it's interesting that you brought that up about like you wanted to do a race and actually feel sort of mentally positive or happy throughout. And is that not, or I guess that's not always the case when you're striving to be really competitive, hey?
For me, it's really the sleep deprivation bit when I'm talking about being happy. Like,
all right.
I can, like, Western States racing hard, that's all fun, that's good, that's happy. It's more the, like, stumbling sleepwalking that to me is not a lot of fun. So I guess it's trying to figure out that balance of getting enough sleep to be functional. And that was one interesting thing for me on the Jordan Trail was I was getting full nights of, well, not exactly full nights of sleep, but we were stopping by like between probably 8 and 9:30 every night. And then starting in the morning, usually around, you know, between 5:30 and 6:30. So there was definitely time to shower, have a big meal, do some maintenance, and get 4 to 5 hours of sleep so that every day when I would start running, I felt really fresh. And so I think had I tried to do more of the sleep deprivation thing, I don't think my legs would have held up as well. But as I did it, like the way I did it, I think that's why I, like, again, my legs never really felt tired or sore throughout. I generally every day when I started, I felt fresh and ready to run again. My feet on the other hand got kind of butchered, but like, I think that's just the, you know, when you're doing like 100,000 steps a day, at some point the balls of your feet are just, That's enough. Like, yeah, we're done. So.
And it looks like the terrain's quite rocky, yeah? I mean, not exclusively, yeah. But...
Yeah, I mean, the Jordan Trail is a really wide mix of terrain. Like, you got everything from paved roads to gravel roads to dirt roads, some single track, and then a lot of off-trail, like, bushwhacking, scrambling through, like, rocky fields and a lot of thorns and spines. And then as you get towards, like the parts between, like, Petra and Wadi Rum, it's like a lot of just like, yeah, baby head rocks and really rocky and yeah, and then eventually turns to sand as you get through the desert. But it definitely is a type of terrain that beats up your feet, and I opted to wear road shoes for probably more than half of it, which was perhaps not the best idea, but they seemed to be what was working best for me at the time. So
yeah, I mean, it's you're right. I mean, yeah, 100,000 steps, no matter what you were wearing, it's going to really, it's going to take it out of you. I mean, you've worked in, you know, some of the most, you know, like stunning places in the world and interesting places in the world. I mean, where's some other place, like where have been some other running experiences around the world that you've really kind of, you know, been in an environment and gone, wow, I'm really kind of fortunate to be here, or not many people have had the opportunity to do what I'm doing right now?
You know, like really so many places. And like I've traveled a lot for work and running. Like up until like I moved here, like I was averaging probably like between 7 and 10 international trips a year, like half for running and half for work. And everywhere I go, like everywhere in the world I've ever been, I've been able to run. So yeah, when you're going somewhere on a running trip, that's one thing. But when you're going somewhere for work, like oftentimes you don't see outside of the office. But because I run everywhere I work, then like, you know, I go to Uganda and I get to run in Toto and like the, you know, in the remote parts of Uganda, and to see things that you wouldn't see if you didn't leave the office and get out and, you know, experience that morning run, or like, you know, running early in the morning in Ethiopia, or you know, wherever you are, you just get to see so much of a place and kind of also every place is a running culture. So you also then get to, you know, kind of figure out what the running culture is and try to, you know, meet some people through that. And it's just been a, yeah, really kind of fun way to see the world. And I think you get to see a lot more of the world when you are a runner and run everywhere you go.
You lace up your shoes. I mean, that's what I was kind of more interested in. It wasn't so much the running trips, although that's interesting. It's the work trips, because it's that sense of, you're right, you could, you know, and I know that Eugene, my co-host, he periodically does a lot of travel with his journalism, and my mother-in-law has done a lot of travel with her development work as well and NGO work, and it's, you get that sense that, like, you can almost go hermetically sealed around the world, not leaving your office or compound or whatever, but there are people such as yourself who sort of decide to engage with the outside world, and that sounds like a much more kind of interesting way to live.
Yeah, I think definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, because so, otherwise you're like, oh, it's great that you get to go to such and such country, but if you're just in an office, you can be in an office in, you know, any country in the world, and it's kind of the same as being in an office in the States, so.
What's the response you generally get when you say to people, and or you said, you were saying to people in Jordan, you know, like, I'm planning to do this Jordan trail, or they find out that you've been running, you know, you've run several hundred mile races and Tour de France. What do people make of that?
Well, at least like with the running I'm on crew, like they're definitely like just getting into ultras within the last couple of years, but there are, that's not true for everyone. There's some that have more than a few years of experience, but like there are ultra runners in the group too, so I don't think they necessarily find it completely shocking. And yeah, I mean, it was great that they jumped on board and were so eager to help and kind of, you know, excited about me taking it on.
And do you have anything else that you're thinking about sort of cracking into, or is it just a time to kind of rest and replenish?
You know, like, there are some local races I'd like to do, like the, I'm forgetting the one, the UTMB by Oman. Oman is not too far away. I'd like to go back to Cappadocia in Turkey. So there's definitely a lot of races that are kind of local to the area. I also went in February before lockdown. We were lucky that, like, the first weekend in February, there was a new trail race in Saudi Arabia, and it was one of the eco trail races. I think it's organized by a French company. And so we took a road trip and drove down from here, drove down to Saudi. And that was absolutely fascinating, because Saudi is opening to tourists, and the rules are changing in terms of like women. But we were driving in places where things have not necessarily yet changed. And so, like, you know, we drive through the city to book, and we go into a restaurant, and there's, you know, A, we haven't seen a woman all day. B, there are no restrooms for women. It's just to kind of see and experience that. The race itself was great, but it was just so interesting, like driving there and back, and just kind of, you know, on the way back, we stopped at McDonalds, which literally only had a men's bathroom. And you're like, wow, like, you know, this is kind of out there.
It's that interesting. But it's that interesting thing, eh? Like, you're in Saudi Arabia, they've got a McDonald's, but they don't have a woman's bathroom. That's jarring, eh? Is that because it's just not expected? That why would a woman be in a restaurant? Exactly.
Like, you know, you're out and about driving around. Like, I was surveying cars, and like, you know, 20 cars pass, zero women. Like, it's women stay home. And I mean, again, things are changing, and in the bigger cities, that's not necessarily the case. But we were not driving through those cities. We were driving in a much more rural area, and so like what we saw was kind of it was kind of eye-opening.
And it sounds like, you know, it would be easy to and I'm sure many people do kind of apply that sort of blanket, this is my perception of, say, a Muslim country to every country that is Muslim, or the faith is predominantly Muslim. It doesn't sound like that is widely the experience in Jordan. Things seem like they're a bit more they're different, say.
Yeah, and things are definitely more liberal here, although, I mean, not nearly as liberal as what you find in, like, say, Lebanon, although Lebanon is also got a different religious makeup. But, I mean, it's part of the reason I wanted to do the Jordan Trail is because everyone that's attempted it so far, and there haven't been a lot of, like, running attempts. It was basically two guys that tried it in 2017, and theirs wasn't necessarily an FKT attempt. It was more of, like, a kind of a stage race that was organized by the Jordan Trail Association. So it was those guys, and then it was Robbie and Dan coming down to do it. But no woman had done it, and so that's one of the reasons I really wanted to do it, was just to, like, you know, to get, you know, women kind of interested in the idea of like planning big adventures and doing these kind of big trail, you know, setting big goals and doing things that are normally seen as being done by men here.
Mm. And is that something that, you know, when you are running and when you're sort of, you know, around the world, that do you use your career or, you know, the successes that you've had to sort of engage with different groups of women who might not necessarily have the same, and I'm by no means am I saying that everything's great and equal in the Western world, because it's not, but who perhaps, you know, have less opportunity to do things.
Yeah, and I guess, I mean, usually when I travel for work, I don't necessarily, it's not necessarily part of like my, what I do. You know, I'm on the compliance and, you know, I have a very specific like thing that I'm doing when I go to a country, but I do, yeah. It's one reason I do think it's important. Like I was in Iraq a few years ago in Kurdish Iraq, but like, I know that it's going to be uncomfortable when I go out and run. I know I'm going to get stared at. But I still like to go out and run just so that, like, you know, like women and girls will see a woman out running on the street. Kind of the one group that I have been involved with is there's an organization called Free to Run, which I'm not sure if you know Stephanie Case. She's a UN human rights lawyer that was living in Afghanistan, and she founded this NGO called Free to Run, and it's about empowering women and youth or women and girls in conflict zones. Primarily through running and different adventure sports activities. And so I did have the opportunity in 2016 to go with her to Bamiyan in Afghanistan. And we took a group of women on kind of an outdoor adventure sports week. And so we did a backpacking trip and did some trail running and biking and volleyball and things like that. And so it was a really fun way to kind of engage with women and get them, you know, out and recreating in places they wouldn't normally be able to recreate.
Wow. And I mean, I guess that's not without its risks in itself. Hey, like even, and I know that in Bamiyan, it's different from say Kabul or, you know, another, or Kandahar say, but, there's
sure.
it's still not somewhere where, you know, you would see a woman running or anything like that.
You know, actually through this NGO Free to Run, they have a number of activities in Bamiyan. And so I think it's, and they have a international marathon there, and they've got some other events. So I think it is becoming, you know, more and more common for them to see the women and the girls, especially the girls in the school are involved and are really excited about running. And so, I mean, I think that's kind of the idea is that, you know, it starts with a small idea and you get, you know, a few women interested, you get, you know, a few more women interested, and it's kind of that that effect that, you know, with more and more women seeing this as a possibility, you get more interest and more participation, and over time that will eventually start to change things.
That's the hope indeed. Anyway, hey, Bamiyan sounds like an amazing an amazing place to just be, just the landscape, the
definitely one of those like top, you know, running memory places is being able to run in Bamiyan for sure.
Yeah. Eugene had the opportunity to do that a while ago, and he said that one of the most sort of hazardous thing was the traffic above anything else. Like he was sort of both awestruck by the place that he was in and quite terrified the fact that he was going to get run over.
It's kind of similar to Jordan's long stuff.
Oh, goodness me. It's always those little unexpected hazards, isn't it? So are you, I mean, in terms of, you know, you staying in Jordan, is this something that you see yourself doing in the long term, or will you go home, or?
You know, I just signed another year lease on my apartment and extended my contract for a year, so I'll probably be here at least another year, and then after that it's hard to say, but you know, it was interesting coming home from the Jordan Trail because I do like Amman, but like as I was coming back from the Red Sea on Tuesday, like and especially after this trip, like I do feel like I have a community here, and I've really bonded with some people in this group, and I felt like I was coming home, and it was a nice feeling to come back to Amman and just appreciate it that much more. So
oh, that's
That's really lovely. It's that sense. I mean, that's true, though, isn't it? It's home is very much where the heart is, and it's not necessarily where you stay.
Where my cats are.
Yeah, I'm sure your cats. I'm sure your cats were super stoked to see you. But did you? Can I just ask a sort of a running nerdy question? And I know, you know, I'm sure I've kept you far too long. But like, in terms of what you subsisted on when you ran the Jordan Trail, were you eating local food or real food, or were you going for sort of sports more classic sort of sports nutrition?
It's funny because my crew afterwards was like, they were telling me how shocked they were by how absolutely crappy my nutrition was. But I definitely evening meals. We had like very big traditional Jordanian meals. So like a lot of big rice and chicken bread dishes with, you know, a lot of the traditional sides. During the day, I think the first day I had 13 Mirindas, which Mirinda is like the Pepsi version of Fanta, so orange soda. And I basically averaged, I think we decided 10 Mirindas a day. So we're looking at somewhere between 80 and 90 Mirindas over the course of the week. Also, something that Stephanie Case taught me about Tor was that, and she typically doesn't eat red meat, but during Tor, she eats McDonald's cheeseburgers. And so last year, I was having some stomach problems and I tried the McDonald's cheeseburger miracle, and they really are like jet fuel during a race. I mean, like, I never eat them during my normal life, but like, because they're not real food, you don't really have to chew them. They just kind of dissolve themselves and you kind of gum them. And I think I had 8 McDonald's cheeseburgers during the event. I also had a lot of Shanina, which Shanina is actually probably one of the healthier things I consume. It's like a salted yogurt drink. I had a lot of ice cream. And yeah, it was really a lot of Mirinda and cheeseburgers.
Well, I guess, I mean, it's
absolutely no like sports nutrition. Like I filled my hydration pack once or twice with, well, that's not true. I also really enjoyed the scratch chocolate recovery drinks because it's really similar to chocolate milk in terms of its flavor and consistency. So I had a lot of that. I probably had 10 packs of the scratch. But I also tried to do like the scratch regular hydration stuff, and I would fill my pack with it. I just wouldn't drink it. So I stopped trying to do it. I would just do water. So.
Wow. And I guess the body knows what it wants. Maybe McDonald's have been marketing their cheeseburgers wrong all these years. Maybe they are the ultimate kind of sports food. I mean, it's probably because, I mean, yeah, you're getting a mix of protein, sugar, and carbohydrates, aren't you? Fat and carbohydrates. Yeah. It's just a perfect little sandwich. And Mirinda, gosh, I haven't thought about that since I was a child, but I guess it's very much the same, isn't it? When you're running that far each day, you could pretty much, you're going to eat what you like.
Yeah, and then we would drink like they're the little cans. So they're probably, I don't know, 250. I don't know what size that is, but those small cans. And yeah, it's kind of a running them on thing is like, it's our drink of choice. And it was funny because two of the crew guys had gone to the grocery store and bought Fanta, and they told Rosam and I that they'd bought Fanta, and Rosam and I looked at each other like, you know, like, excuse me? Like, so we actually had them, we went back and bought Mirinda, and the Fanta's kind of sat out of the cooler, and we would gift them to children along the way because we're like, yeah, we can't really drink the Fanta. So
yeah, not on brand. Oh my goodness. And are you able to look at Mirinda now that you've stopped?
You know, I haven't yet had one. I do have a couple in my fridge, but I think it's going to take a few more days until I mean, it's really, I don't ever drink them unless I'm during a run or after a run, and I haven't yet gone for a run. So I guess I'll wait for my first run to really enjoy those.
How, in terms of recovery, how long do you, I mean, I guess you've never run the Jordan Trail before, but like after a big race or something like Tour de Jean or Western States, how long is your recovery?
You know, like if we weren't, when I have a treadmill, so it's not a complete excuse, but, or it's a bad excuse, but like, had I been able to go outside today, I might've gone for a short run.
Right.
It's been, I guess I finished on Saturday. So today marks like a full week of time off. So yeah, probably tomorrow I'll try to go out and jog a few miles. I went for a walk on Thursday in part because the lockdown was coming and knew that I would be shut inside. And so went for, you know, a four mile walk and it felt great. So yeah, I'll probably do something active starting tomorrow and then just kind of see how my body feels and take it easy for another week or so.
And then sort of back into it. And in terms of the lockdown, is that something that you're going to be juggling for the next while? Do they have a plan around, like, are they, you know, they're shutting down for the weekends? Is that for the next couple of months or?
That's kind of what it sounds like, yeah, unfortunately. So it's kind of frustrating because, like, we got locked down during spring, and spring is like we have a kind of a 4 to 6 week period in Jordan where everything is green, right. And it's a beautiful time of year, and we were basically locked down for the spring, and now autumn has finally hit and the weather is gorgeous and we're locked down again. And so it's kind of like we've missed the really nice, like, few months of the year. And then in the summer, it's just like ungodly hot. And in the winter, it's kind of cold and rainy. So I'm hoping that we won't be locked down for the whole autumn, but we'll see what happens.
Oh my goodness. Well, I hope that things, you know, as difficult as it is, I hope that things sort of come right. We've just had all our restrictions lifted, apart from sort of contact tracing and, you know, like the emphasis on hygiene. But we went into it's shown how a sort of
a good leader will
we're generally pragmatic and quite compliant. It's turned out, like, people might have a little bit of a grumble, but when, you know, when we all had to go inside, like, it literally everyone went okay and just went, you know, like, you know, and how many people are in Jordan? I'm not, is it analogous to New Zealand or much, probably quite a bit bigger?
We're like 10 million.
Right. So twice the size of New Zealand. So, yeah, I mean, it helps that, you know, there's, you know, we are an island nation and, you know, we're down the bottom of the world. That certainly helps. But yeah, everyone sort of just sucked it up and got on with it, which was helpful. Mm-hmm. Look, Amy, thank you so much for speaking with me. And again, behind the scenes, there was a timing miscalculation on my part. So thank you for making time again. We've got one question that we ask everyone who comes on Dirt Church Radio, and that's, hey, Amy Sproston, what's your greatest run ever?
You know, this may sound cheesy, but I think I'm going to go with the last week on the Jordan Trail.
I don't think that sounds cheesy at all. It's
it was just an amazing experience, and my crew was absolutely amazing. There were a lot of times during the run where I was like, especially the last few days, where I was like, I really just don't want this to end because it's just kind of like the dream experience.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And I mean, I wish you well for the future, and also thank you for the work that you do, and I'm hopeful that, you know, where you are can get back to some semblance of normalcy soon.
Thanks, and it was great talking with you.
That was one of my favourite quotes, I think, from ever. You don't even need to chew them, you just gum them down. I mean, you know, sure, like, you can absolutely gum them down, but
yeah, I mean, depends, doesn't it? Yeah. It's all circumstance,
man. Oh. But
hey, thanks for getting up early to do that.
Oh, and thank you to Amy for her generosity, because I balls up the date. But you know, it's those datelines are tough.
They are tough.
Oh, that was amazing. I thought about, you know, like, it's so, it's again, it's one of those ones where you think about, so easy to apply your kind of, or my sort of ignorance of the area, obviously, you know, like when she said, you know, you're looking out, you've got Palestine, the Sea of Galilee, you know, Jerusalem, like, it's like a crucible of humanity, right?
And absolutely.
It's a place where lots went on, but sounds like a beautiful cosmopolitan,
yeah,
amazing place. So.
Yeah.
And, you know,
Petra.
Thanks to Amy for the work that she does.
Mm.
Difficult job.
Yeah.
And a difficult time. Yeah. And thank you very much.
To everyone.
Very much for everyone for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. We're at email at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And you can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms. And you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com.
Oh, you're going to make me say that, but all right, if we're not where we are, no, we're always, I always mess that up.
If we're not where you want us,
let us know. Don't subscribe. Don't forget, don't subscribe. Don't bother subscribing. Don't forget to subscribe and rate us. This is terrible. Like, I'm not worth one star at the moment. You better carry on, Matt.
If you like what you see, please spread the love. It would be great as many people heard the show as possible, and for that, we need your help. Don't forget to write in with your greatest run ever. We'd love to hear from you.
And like you say, they are really good quality at the moment.
Amazing.
Yeah. Well, they always are.
They've ever been true.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you to our sponsors, Scott Running for the fastest, Spring Energy CLE, and thank you to our Patreon supporters and Wild Things.
Yep. Thanks to our editor, Kieran. We've got a great guest lined up for you next week, so please tune in then. Ka kite.
Ka kite anō. Thanks, Rigby.